Welcome to PG Padshala. My name is Dr. D. Dayalan. I am ex-director Archaeological Survey of India. Today we'll talk about under the Indian culture, the paper principles and methods of archaeology. We'll discuss on the principle for conservation. Actually, when you come to these principles of conservation, there are many things to be understand. First thing, we know what is the Indian culture. What is the culture? There are two categories of culture. One is the tangible and intangible cultures. And then there are a lot of international and national conservation policies are there. And apart from that, there are many acts and rules for the maintenance of the national cultural heritages. And we also about to know the various terms is used for the conservation process, like monuments, archaeological sites and remains, antiquities, conservation, preservation, reconstruction, renovation, and then consolidation, authenticity, integrity, etc. You know that India is a very glorious past. It is having a very remarkable cultural heritage right from the prehistoric time. Indeed, it is the faithful expression of the creative activities of the humankind throughout throughout the age. The diversity of Indian culture in the country is not only the great pride for all of us, and also it is irreparable source for spiritual and intellectual richness of the humankind. The cultural properties are broadly classified as, I told earlier, tangible and intangible properties. Tangible properties are mainly the historical buildings, sculptures, manuscripts, paintings, structural, historical, and aesthetic value. And the intangible properties are music, drama, dance, folk art, and traditional crafts of anti-crafts, etc. The archaeological conservation must be an ancient practice because it was not just started very recently. The archaeological conservation must have been started very early period, and for that we have a lot of archaeological evidences which has been proved in the various monuments. In India, the maintenance and preservation and repair of the archaeological tradition or archaeological monuments has very long tradition. Particularly in the ancient Vastu, Silpa and Agamic canons, which mainly talks about not only about the building construction, iconic feature, but also discuss about the various methods and principles of renovation, restoration of the ancient buildings. There are many international and national conservation policies and documents. The one which is very prominent among that is the Athens Charter in 1931, and then Venice Charter 1964, then Nara documents on authenticity 1994, Bura Charter 1999, and General Conference of UNESCO, that is United Nations Education Scientific Cultural Organization meeting in Paris 1972, in which they talks about the World Heritage Monuments. There are two major organizations, there are out of many organizations, there are two major organizations which is mainly responsible for the cultural heritage or the maintenance of the heritage in the world. One is ICOMOS, that is International Council on Monuments and Sites, was founded in 1965, which is headquartered in Paris. The other one is ICROM, that is International Center for the Study of the Preservation and Restoration of the Cultural Properties. It was established in 1959 and it based at Rome. And apart from that, in India, we have many conservation policies. One is the Conservation of Ancient Monument 1907, that is one. And then after that, Sir John Marshall, the then Director General of Archaeology, he has written a manual, and that was in 1923. It is supposed to be one of the very authentic conservation principles even now we are using in the archaeological conservation works. And recently, there is a national conservation policy was been adopted, that is in 2014. It is now in force. There are many acts and rules for the protection of the archaeological monuments and sites in India. Mainly, the important among them is the Indian Treasure Trove Act 1878, and then Ancient Monument Preservation Act 1904, and then Indian Ancient Monuments and Archaeological Sites and Remains, that is AMASRA Act 1958, and then followed by the rule of the same act, that is the Ancient Monuments and Archaeological Remains and Rules 1959, and then recently the Ancient Monuments and Archaeological Sites and Remains Amendment Valuation Act 2010. Actually, the 2010 is very important because in which they are talking about the restriction of the construction in the 100 meter and the further 200 meter. That is the prohibited and regulated zone of the archaeological monuments. Ancient monuments, it is generally as per the act. Ancient monuments is mean that any structure or erection or monument or any tumulus or the place of interment or any cave or rock sculptures, inscriptions, monolithic, which is of historical, archaeological and artistic interest, which has been in existence for not less than 100 years and includes the remains of the ancient monument, sites of an ancient monument, such portion of land adjoining to the site of the ancient monument as may be required for the fencing and covering in or otherwise preserving for such monument. It means also the access to the monuments for any inspection purpose or for the visitors' movement. These are all some of the historical monuments. Actually, we have India, we have very rich cultural heritage monuments of different varieties. We have the rock cut caves, monolithics, structural temple, palaces, forts, masjid, and then mosques, churches. Like that, we have varieties of cultural heritages right from the prehistoric till the very recent period. Then comes the archaeological sites and remains. Archaeological sites and remains means any area which contains or is reasonably believed to contain the ruins or relics of historical or archaeological importance which has been in existence for not less than 100 years. This is the general definition of the archaeological sites and remains as per the Act. It also includes the area adjoining to the archaeological sites and also access to the sites as well as remains. It's also a part and parcel of the archaeological remains and then sites. So we have varieties of archaeological sites in India, right from the excavated remains, many mounds which is containing the archaeological remains, and also some of the megalithic sites, prehistoric sites, Neolithic sites. Like that, there are varieties of archaeological sites in India. This is one very important site called Dholavira, where the whole Harappan complex has been excavated. This is one of the very important archaeological sites in India. And then we have different types of megalithic sites, particularly in South India. There are large number of megalithic sites spread over the whole over South India. This is one type of megalithic site, particularly in Kerala region. The antiquities, again, it's very important because it's ongoing. It's very important for the archaeological studies. The ancient antiquities means any coin, sculpture, manuscripts, epigraph, or other works of art or craftsmanship. It is all considered as antiquity. Or any article or object or things detached from the caves or the buildings is also a part of antiquities. Or any article or objects or things illustrative of science, art, craft, literature, religion, custom, moral or politics in bygone ages, it's also considered as an antiquity. And any objects or articles or things of historical interest, and any article, objects or things declared by the central government by notification in the Gazette, government notification as antiquities for the first purpose of the Act, it is also considered as an antiquities. We have different types of antiquities in India, like coins and then sculptures, both bronze sculptures, stone sculptures, and then copper plates, plaques, terracottas, coins, and also the various antiquities which has been retrieved from the archaeological excavations. It's also considered as an archaeological antiquities. There are different terms which have been used for the archaeological conservation. There is known as conservation, preservation, maintenance, other thing. It's all defined, well defined in the various acts as well as the various quorums. Particularly the definition of conservation, it means conservation includes all acts that prolong the life of our cultural heritage or natural heritage from any further decay without changing their character. This is the definition of conservation. The historical value and material authenticity of the monument has to be safeguarded through their process. The minimum effective action is always the best. If possible, the action should be reversible and not prejudice possible for the future intervention. So this is the general introduction or the general concept of conservation. The conservation has to be made. Before taking up a conservation, we have to make certain parameters on some studies. Particularly, we have to study the location where the monument has been existing. Suppose it is a coastal area or rainfall area, snowfall area or arid area. First, we have to define so that the conservation go according to the location of the monuments. Second thing, the environment, because it's a wet condition, dry condition, urban region, rural, industrial area. Again, it will go as per the conservation has to depends on the environment of the monument in which it is existing now. And the material used, because our monuments are constructed in different material, like wood has been used, brick has been used, stone, mud, stucco, and other materials has been used. So that's also to be studied before taking up any conservation. Then the style of conservation, construction. For example, there may be a temple, there may be a church, mosque, port, palaces, etc. So even the style of, the construction, our conservation methodology also depends on, construction. And cause of deterioration. There are many causes for the deterioration of the ancient monument, mainly the environmental causes, biological causes, man-made causes, natural calamities, and many other causes are there. And also we have to see the status of deterioration, whether it is initial stage or almost in the damaging stage, or it can be conserved or it can be preserved, so that we can decide on the basis of these parameters, one, the location, environment, materials used, style of conservation, construction, cause of deterioration, status of deterioration. These are all the parameters to be used to take up any conservation work. And this is the one major conservation was taken up at Sun Temple, Konark. Actually, is one of the World Heritage Monument, where it's a big challenge for the archaeologist to conserve this building, since it has many defects, particularly the saline action, sand blasting, then other various problems are there. So this is one of the method to show how the conservation has been taken for the archaeological monuments. Then comes the preservation. Preservation is to maintain the cultural property in existing condition. So this is the definition of the preservation. Then comes the consolidation. An attempt of physical addition or application of consolidation into the fabric, the original fabric of the cultural property, in order to ensure its sustained durability without interfering its integrity. Because always the integrity is very important. Without interfering the integrity, the consolidation has to be taken place. So these are some of the consolidation work taken place in the monuments at Ajanta and various other places, particularly the Buddha statue, which has, because of the nature of the rock, it is basically made of basaltic, it is excavated in the basaltic rock, and because of the nature of the rock, that the many of the portion has been deteriorating, it has been consolidated without changing the fabric, without changing the character of the structure. So this is the way how the ancient sculpture or monument has to be conserved or consolidated. Next comes the restoration. There are many methods to restore. Particularly, restoration means the replacement or reproduction of missing or decayed or deteriorated structural members of the monument, or geometric or floral pattern, etc. That is the restoration. As per the rule, the mural paintings, sculptures, inscriptions, engravings, or sketches of the ancient monument or site should not be restored. Only the monuments has to be restored, not touching to the very integral carvings, as well as the artistic designs, as well as inscriptions and sculptures. So these are some of the restorations carried out in various monuments. Particularly this one is Agra. where the plaster has been decayed and this has been restored as per the original. Similar way, the ancient tiles which has been fallen or broken, that has been restored as per the original by analyzing the original fabric of the ancient one as well as the new one. And this is another important work of restoration Taj Mahal, where as you know that Taj Mahal is very famous for the inlay works, and particularly the inlay works have been carried out on the sandstone ground with marble as well as various semi-precious stones. Here on the rear side of the Taj Mahal, the sandstone has been inlaid with a marble. Many places the marble has lost. This has been restored as per the original by petrographic and analyzing the original one, and also doing as per the original. This is one of the method how the restoration has to be carried out in the ancient monuments. Reconstruction. Reconstruction has to be restricted to the extent the archaeological or other authentic evidence are available about its original state, and it should not be done on the basis of any conjecture. Actually, restoration has to be done as per the existence available on the site, or otherwise if there any evidence are available how it was originally exist. Otherwise it could not be done on the basis of any conjecture or hypothesis way. Deconstruction has to be carried out by using the same fabric or material as per the original, because always when it is absolutely necessary, reconstruction has to be done. It should be done by using the same fabric and material. Otherwise you should not use anything which is not compatible with the original fabric of the monument. These are some of the reconstruction, because the Hanumakonta in Telangana state, where the 1000 pillar mandapa, it is totally in a collapsed condition. So there is no other way except to reconstruct it. It has been done very meticulously. Each and every stone has been removed from there after detailed documentation, and then after dismantling the whole thing, it has been reconstructed as per the original by using the same material. So this is the meticulous way of reconstructing the ancient monument. So this is another example of reconstruction at Fatehpur Sikri, where the ceiling slab has been fallen, but fortunately it is all available the site itself. So we actually retrieved all the missing slab or the fallen slab and then put it in the original place. So without changing the character of the monument, and also without adding any new structural material, it has been reconstructed with the original fabric as the original material. So this is again an example how the reconstruction has to be taken place. Repair is another type which has been normally used in the conservation methodology. Repair means removing or replacing decayed or damaged material or portion of an ancient structure with the objective to impart stability. So again, repair is only required when the stability question is required. It's been a question. And then the cultural landscape. Actually, cultural landscape has been used in the archaeological concept or also archaeological contest. Basically, it is a combination of nature and man. Because any archaeological monument, it has been some historical settings. So the historical setting has also to be preserved along with the monument, because it is having some sort of a compatibility or historical significance of that place. The authenticity is very important, because any conservation work has to be carried out, the authenticity has to be kept in mind. The authenticity means is the value that has been bestowed upon by all its forms and historical period that has been conserved. While doing conservation, we have to keep very meticulous to maintain the authenticity of the monument. The concept of progressive authenticity, which means the layers of history that the cultural property has acquired through the time, are being considered as authenticity, because periodically there will be some additions, alteration has been carried out. It's also part of an authenticity that also to be maintained, that also to be preserved along with the original monument. And generally the authenticity having many parameters. The one is the forms and design, and then material and substance, use and function, tradition, techniques and management system, location and setting, spirits and feeling, and other national and international factors. These are all the some of the attributes of the authenticity. Again, another important thing is integrity. When taking up any conservation work, the integrity is also be kept in mind and it should be preserved. The integrity means the wholeness or intact of the natural and or cultural heritage and its attributes. The condition of integrity of the cultural heritage are, there are many conditions for maintaining the integrity of the cultural heritages. Then we need a strong management system to conserve the heritage. Unless we have the proper managing or mechanism, then it is very difficult to conserve the archaeological remains as well as the heritage of the ancient India. First thing is a thorough shared understanding of the ancient monument or archaeology sites and remains by all stakeholders. It's very important because it should be shared with all the stakeholders who have been involved in the conservation or management of the historical heritages. Secondly, a cyclic planning, implementation, monitoring, evaluation and feedback, it should be needed. And the involvement of partners and stakeholders. Because any heritage management, it needs the involvement of the stakeholders and then the partners who has involved, so that it will be a very healthy heritage management. And then we have to create a capacity building so that the future generations should also know what the conservation is there, what are the heritage managements are there. It should be also be taken into mind. And then the conservation management should be a transparent and it should be a very functionary and very meticulous. And then the usage of the heritage property, it should be a very sustainable way, because it should not be any way go against the historical value or the historical sense of the monument. It should be used in a very perfect manner, and the sustainable use of the historical or cultural heritage is very important. The cultural property may be supported by the proper usage, and it should be ecologically as well as culturally sustainable. And it is essential to ensure that the sustainable use of the cultural property does not adversely impact the historical aesthetic significance, integrity, authenticity of the ancient heritage. And generally, in the Government of India, it is a policy to maintain the ancient monument and the same status as it was existed at the time of declaring it a protected monument. So, what are the things? Suppose it is a monument which is a living monument, or it is a monument under worship, the same status has to be maintained even today. So, this is the government policy now we are adopting. As I told earlier, that the ancient monuments and sites are the testimony of our civilization, and it is the one of the representation of the cultural heritage, and it is the responsibility of every human being to preserve it for the posterity, because it is all not only an archaeological important, it is the important of all aspects. There are many policies in India as well as the world to conserve the monuments right from the beginning, because the government or the whole humankind is aware or they are understood that it is very important to preserve the archaeological remains or the archaeological heritages, and there are a lot of policies has been adopted right from the beginning. As I told earlier, this Athens and then Venice, then Nara Charter, Bura Charter, then there are many adaptation has been made by the UNESCO, that is United Nations Education Scientific Cultural Organization, time to time to preserve the cultural heritage for the posterity, and also how to take care of the monuments for further deterioration or any additions or alteration. And there are many procedures which has been followed in the conservation. One of the mainly is conservation, how the conservation is to be defined, and then restoration, renovation, reconstruction. These are all the some of the terminologies or some of the methodologies which has been used for the conservation process. And then there are many definitions which has been made, like heritage management, how it should be heritage to be managed, and also how it should be managed in a sustainable way without affecting the historical aesthetic as well as the integrity or the sustainability of the monument. that also to be taken into care. To know more about the archaeological conservation and archaeological methodologies, archaeological management, there are a few books and articles are available in the various journals as well as the various books. Mainly the archaeological manual, conservation manual by Sazan Marshall is one of the very authentic books. Still it has been adopted in the archaeological conservation work. Apart from that, the different conservation work carried out by the Archaeological Survey of India right from the beginning till date, it has been available in the Indian Archaeological Review, and you can go through that one so that you can able to understand the various conservation methodologies have been adopted along with the illustration. It is available, so that also you can see. And then in ancient India there is one journal in which there are very very learned articles has been published on archaeological conservation, archaeological preservation, and then the paintings, chemical preservation, all the things. That also you can go through on that. And then few books like Bernard Fielden, it is one of the very authentic book which gives a lot of information about the archaeological conservation. In addition to that, there are many archaeological conservations are available, not only in India, throughout the world it is available in the website as well as the e-Pathasala. So that also you can go through to understand the archaeological conservation as well as archaeological management system. And thank you for your patience. Thank you very much.